I'll tell you the best popular song ever written. Would you like to know? May I, my opinion? The most perfect popular song. I wonder who's kissing her now. Says the entire story right there and then. You don't have to know another word. I wonder who's teaching her how, so on and so on. It's well developed. I wonder if she ever tells him of me. I wonder, it's a perfect popular song. A real popular song, in my opinion, must have the title and a great melody underneath it embody the entire song so that after you've sung the first line, you can say, I wonder who's kissing her now. La, 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 la. Your own imagination creates the rest of the song.
And now, for your enjoyment and edification, our sweet and sagacious songstress, soaring through strata of sublime serendipity, a vivid-voiced vehicle, void of all vestige of vulgarity. Miss Maria Weber!
Around about 1880 or so, a gentleman named Chas K. Harris from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, put up a shingle in front of his shop
saying, songs written to order. Now, he played the banjo. This, I think, was a first in pop. It was the first time that anybody had actually advertised the fact that they would write all kinds of songs. So he wrote songs for births, deaths, marriages, all that kind of thing. One day, he wrote a song, a three-verse ballad, which he was very proud of, called After the Ball, which told a very long and Victorian story, A Broken Love. That's the tune. So he wrote this, he carpentered the tune on his banjo.
After the ball is over, after the break of morn.
A show was coming through town called A Trip to Chinatown. And it was typical of those days, because what they do was to stick a hit song into a show of this kind if they thought it would help it, help the show, I mean. Well, they put this song in, and on the first night when it was playing, it absolutely brought down the house. And Chas K made millions and millions of dollars from this song alone.
I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Songwriting is a part of capitalism, is a part of the money-making system. I mean, people are in it mostly to make money, as we are in everything else, to make a living. And you make your living by producing articles that people will buy. And since the taste of the average audience is about, what, it used to be 12 years old, I think we've improved, it must be 13 now. And so you produce songs that will sell in quantities. Well, what kind of song will sell in quantities? The kind of song that appeals to the 12, 13, 14-year-old mind.
Through my first published song, I learned a lot of the fundamentals of songwriting, and I have never forgotten them. The successful popular songwriter writes for the average piano player and the average singer. For instance, here is one of my coon songs. Rufus Randus, gentle brown, What you gonna do when the rain comes round? You'll notice the range of that song was only 6 notes. Why, a baby could almost sing it. She's only a bird in a gilded cage. A beautiful sight to see. Every one of those songs was a real smash hit. Each one contained some human note, and every one was easy to play and easy to sing.
I've got a little baby, but she's out of sight. I talked to her across the telephone. I've never seen my honey, but she's mine, all right. So take my tip and leave this gal alone.
Every single morning you can hear me yell, "Hey Central, fix me up across the line." They connect me with my baby, then I ring the bell, and this is what I say to baby mine. Hello my baby, hello my honey, hello my ragtime gal. Send me a kiss by wire, baby my heart's on fire. If you refuse me, honey, you'll lose me, then you'll be left alone. So baby, telephone and tell me I'm your own. Hello, hello. If you refuse me, honey, you'll lose me, then you'll be left alone. So baby, telephone and tell me I'm your telephone.
So Chez Kay moved to New York and started an office there where he published his own songs. And in 1902 or so, he published a book called How to Write a Popular Song.
Just around the corner, maybe sunshine for you.
Sounds good.
Just around the corner.
Skies above may be blue.
Skies above may be blue. Keep a little smile on. That's the right thing to do.
Can you get something like this? In a little while, your troubles.
Yes. In a little while, your troubles, they will disappear like bubbles.
Bubbles? Troubles? Isn't that a little too simple?
The simpler the better, Dolph, for a popular song hit. Even though it's dark and cloudy.
We get something, sun may peep through and say howdy.
That sounds good. Even though it's dark and cloudy, sun may peep through and say howdy. Just around the corner from you.
Most of my songs that have sold were written in less than 15 minutes. Tea for Two was written in less than 4 minutes. I Want to Be Happy in about 12 minutes. Swanee, Gershwin and I wrote that in about 15 or 20 minutes, and there was a game going on in the parlor of his home. Just a Gigolo, no, that took me overnight, because it was the theme, you know. It required a little work.
But no matter how quickly the songs were written, they still had to be published. The question was where?
There's a fruit store on our street. It's run by a Greek. And he sells.
Inevitably, the natural place was next door to the vaudeville theatres, so that they could immediately take their latest song to the resident star, persuade him to sing it, and thus make it a hit.
Tells you, yes, we have no bananas. Oh, we have no bananas.
This was a case of being confronted by the enemy twice a day in the vaudeville houses, later three or four times a day. Confrontation. But the important thing was that you had an audience. And it's a strange thing, something eerie about that, how without coast-to-coast network, without radio,
songs sold in the millions.
The idea of mass producing ready-made songs, however, had not been American. It was European. Street hawkers, many of them Jewish, had been doing a brisk trade in topical songs about murders, disasters, and for decades in London, Paris, and so on. Victorian America had already imported French chateaus brick by brick, so why not European musicians and their know-how?
We move on to the Broadway sector, commonly known as Tin Pan Alley, where most of the music publishers have their headquarters. Here we are in the studios of a famous music company where Broadway's musical celebrities are selecting songs. In one of the many piano rooms, we find Jane Pickens of the famous Pickens sisters.
Tin Pan Alley got its name on 46th Street between Broadway and 6th Avenue. Now, a lot of people say that Tin Pan Alley started down on 28th Street, which is not so. The reason it was called Tin Pan Alley, that most of the music publishing companies that were on 46th Street were like on the first floor of houses that had about 10 steps. We used to call them stoops. And in the summertime, when it was beastly hot, there were no air conditioning units in those days, you used to open up the window. And naturally, you'd hear the sound of a piano and a voice singing. Then you go down to the next door, there's another music publishing company, and there's a piano going and a singer, and he's singing a ballad, this one is singing a ragtime song, and it sounded like someone was beating some tin pans, and that's why they called it Tin Pan Alley.
Babs Ryan and her brothers rehearse a new number.
Trouble, what a business.
Over 50,000 were copyrighted for each year. Now, for every song that's copyrighted, there's about 10 in the pocket of the person who copyrighted it. Is that right? So in those days, it was safe to assume that a half a million songs were written each year. The songs represented the growth of the country. We had songs like, "Won't You Come Along, Lucille, in My Merry Oldsmobile? Where Do You Work at, John? On the Delaware Lackawanna, we were building the railroads," and so forth. Now, the kids today write ideological songs as though they discovered the Brave New World of tomorrow, which is ridiculous. I've been writing those songs ever since I started writing songs.
Xavier Cugat, popular orchestra leader, is in search of a new dance tune for his Spanish band.
Hello, Mr. Cugat.
Hello, Evelyn.
How are you?
Glad to see you. Do you have some new tangos or rumbas?
Yes, we just got something in this morning called The Rhythm of the Valley.
Oh, yes, that's very good. Yeah.
Well, everybody seems to think that Tin Pan Alley is an American term. This is not true. The name started actually in England. Now, Tin Pan Alley was originally called Denmark Street.
It's London's Tin Pan Alley, birthplace of melodies which have kept Britain singing in good times and in bad. It's a friendly street, with each paving stone a rendezvous. Johnny Johnson, leader of the Keynotes, holds highway conference with songwriter Tommy Connor, while the Beverly Sisters are hot on the trail of a new song. Here's Jimmy Campbell with Eddie Standry, and Dave Toff with Pat Halpin. Lawrence Wright, known to most as Horatio Nichols, what a wealth of memories in the heart of one man. Showing his old triumphs to Henry Hall is the daddy of Tin Pan Alley, whose songs have touched with sunshine and melody the home life of a nation.
What used to happen in those days, there were only 12 publishers, that's all, and there were literally hundreds of artists looking for songs. And they used to come down to Denmark Street, and the first publisher who saw a singer walking down Denmark Street used to grab him by the scruff of the neck, take him up to his office, and start pounding out the new song on the piano. Meanwhile, all the other song pluckers got hold of saucepan lids and dustbin lids and kettles and anything, banging outside of us to try and kill the plug. That's why it was called Tin Pan Alley. It's got nothing whatsoever to do in America.
Paramount Pictorial has asked us to say a few words about our work. Well, I better start first by introducing the other member of us, Miss Dana Suise. Dana is a composer. She writes the music, and I try to invent lyrics as good as her melodies. Some job.
Thanks, Eddie. I hope the folks will think so, too. First, we're going to do Ho Hum for you.
Ho Hum, spring is here now. Ho Hum, skies are very clear now. Ho Hum.
I would pretend that I had a title for a song. Let's say, Cliff, I've got a great idea for a song. It ought to go something like this, and we'd sit down and write the song. Go to dinner or have fun. It was all fun. I mean, it was a bohemian atmosphere, in a way.
This is a strange copy of the Washboard Blues. Now, this was the silliest song ever written, one of the first of the blues songs in 1924 that had the kind of a, different. I can't tell you how different. Well, you'd have to hear it. Here's The Nearness of You, written with Ned Washington. Here's an old copy of Stardust. Piano copy. Just piano. See that? Just piano, no words. Instrumental. And here's a copy of Stardust I've never even seen before. And it has the words. Sometimes I wonder why I spend the lonely nights dreaming of a song. And here's Stardust in a mambo tempo. And it was recorded, by somebody. It was recorded as a mambo. What's his name? As a mambo, and it worked out real great.
They were incestuous. They married one another. They lived with one another. They spent all working day long with their own kind of people. They manufactured their own environment. When ragtime became popular, it had been created by blacks. It was taken over by whites. It became successful as a white manifestation of music.
Irving Berlin became known as a ragtime composer. When the blues became important, Tin Pan Alley became aware of the blues, it took over the blues. And the word blues would be attached to a title, and suddenly a Tin Pan Alley songwriter written the blues. It was not in the blues form, it was called the blues because it said blues.
Every big music publisher had a battery of what he called song pluggers. They prefer to be called publisher's representatives, we call them pluggers. And they would appear wherever you were appearing, at a theater or a radio station. Lots of times went to dinner with some of them, or went to the races, or played golf, or did whatever songs the firm at that time was concentrating on, they'd give you a demonstration. They'd come to the dressing room and sing them for you if you wanted, or bring a piano player and demonstrate the song that they currently had hopes of developing into a hit. And if you liked it, you'd put it in the program.
See? How are you going to mix with a tune like that?
Dave, from the heart, terrible. I'll take it up with the committee, but I don't know.
You don't know?
Most of them are old entertainers, retired people who'd been involved, whose act had flopped. So they worked for these firms. They were flashy guys. Most of them were real colorful.
I got to hear the most sensational number of the century. Everybody's after it, the way I figure.
They could sing, they could dance, they knew all the jokes. You rather were happy to see them, because it was always an amusing interlude to visit with these guys, listen to their songs, and they all had the same line, you know, this is going to be the big one. We're going to really work on this. If we can get you and so-and-so to record it and maybe get it on two or three times on the network, this is going to be Bing, I promise you. This is going to be the number one song. There's no question about it.
Let's try a few bars of it anyway, Billy, see what happens.
Some were specialists in contacting the artist. They had that kind of personality, and they had charm and so forth. I mean, it's a question of salesmanship. So that was one type of song plugger. The other type of song plugger made a specialty of visiting the little orchestras. In those days, most inns and hotels across the country had a little eight-piece orchestra, and they were very important.
Upon the February morn, a tiny baby boy was born, Abraham, Abraham. When he growed up, this tiny babe, folks all called him Honest Abe, Abraham.
The song pluggers also used to go out with a horse and wagon, and we'd go to the neighborhoods, wherever the street corner was that was most traversed, you know. We'd push the tailboard down, we'd have two fellas on the tailboard, and I'd be inside at the piano. And they would sing, take your girlie to the movies, if you can't make love at home, And then they'd be singing this through the homemade megaphone by the sheet machine. They'd sell it for 10 cents. That's the way we used to do it.
Now take your girlie to the movies. If you can't make love at home, there's no little brother there who always squeals, and you can do a lot of things in seven reels.
We go to the theaters. We'd come in there with slides, and they'd have what they call the bouncing ball. I don't know if you've ever seen that.
Praise rhythm, here's the doorway. I'll go my way, you'll go your way. Praise rhythm, from now on we're through. Here's where we have a showdown. I'm too high hat, you're too low down. Praise the rhythm, here's goodbye to you.
But a lot of the piano players, instead of playing with their fingers, they used to play with their knuckles, because the music that came out was like in between the keys, you know? And the majority of them never knew how to transpose from one key to another. And that's why Irving Berlin had this great piano of his, where he could only play with one finger to begin with. And if the song was written in the key of C, and it was too low for you, he didn't know how to transpose to the key of E flat, which was two tones higher. But he had a little gimmick underneath the piano, a rod, and he'd just push it to the left to make it higher, and if it was too high, he'd push it to the right.
Come on along, and let me take you by the hand up to the man, the leader man, who's the leader of the band. And if you'd care to hear the Swanee River play in ragtime, come on along, come on and hear Alexander's ragtime band.
You want to be good in time, but nothing can be again.
I remember a song I sang as a little kid in a minstrel show, all about the West and the land of the... In the land of the buffalo, where the western winds do blow, all about the land of the buffalo. And probably the fellow who wrote it had never been west of New York, but he had imagination. Well, that goes for Swanee and the great Swanee River. You know, Stephen Foster's, everyone knows, way down upon the Swanee River. He never saw the Swanee River. And when George and I wrote, Swanee, how I love, we never saw the Swanee River. We hadn't been south of the Battery, right here in New York City. After the song became a hit, we took a trip down Florida. We were very young, and the porter on the train knew something about us, and he, as we crossed the border from Georgia to Florida, he said, boys, there's that river you wrote about. And we went out into the vestibule of the train and looked down, and it was a good thing we wrote the song first. It's a nice, muddy little stream, romantic, I grant you. But there it was, and we saw it for the first time.
Here's one that did mighty good for me. I wrote it in about 31, and it's been a hit for many, many, many years. Lazy River came next, and I wrote that one as a slow tune. That way, you know, real ballady. And recorded it that way with the Dorsey brothers on the orchestra. I hired about five or six guys and made it for Victor Records in that slow tempo. And I sang it in the Rudy Vallée style, which was all wrong. It should have been sung up tempo and with some guts, you know. And that finally happened. Years later, this Sherwood woman, remember Sherwood? I can't say her first name now. But she made a record of it for Decca. Up tempo, up a lazy river where the old mill run meets lazy, lazy river in the noonday sun. Linger in the shade of a kind old tree. Throw away the troubles and dream a dream of me. Well, that made it a great big hit. And she was a good friend of mine, the Sherwood person.
Had always been a hobby with me until I took my first trip to Southern California. While there, I wrote a song that a publisher heard and accepted called In a Little Spanish Town. Was on a night like this, stars were peekabooing down. Was on a night like this, popular enough for the publisher to ask me to write a group of Spanish songs. Perhaps you might remember them. It happened in Monterey. Ramona.
Songs to order? I can write songs to order. I get paid a lot of money for songs to order. A woman came into this office. Would you like to hear a story? This is only recently. And she said, Mr. Caesar, we'd like you to write a song, some songs for little children of the age of 3. Well, I thought it was one of these charity things, you know, and I'd done so many of them that I said, well, whom do you represent? She said, the Cleanliness Bureau. So I thought it was one of these philanthropic organizations. I said, look, I'm so tired, and I've written, so many songs without payment, you know, for these for causes, philanthropies. I said, I'll give you a few $100, and you go and get one of these jingle writers, and they'll write you a good jingle for little children of 3. Oh, no, you must be the one to write it. I said, but I'm awfully busy, really I am, and I'm sort of not in the mood. She said, well, if you write it, I can get a budget. Well, when I heard the word budget, I said, but this may be business. I said, come into my office, madam. Up to the time, our interview was in the outside office. I said, what is your problem? And she said, well, I'd like you to write a song for little children of 3 to teach them to wash their hands after they've been on the little pot. I said, madam, I said, I've been writing songs all these years, and this is the first time I've had this type of challenge. First of all, to write a song for a child of 3 is something to conjure with. I said, but for a child of 3, after it's been on the little... She said, but if you write one so I can show to my budget committee, I'll get you to write a series and record them, and we'll pay you. I said, well... I said, I'll have to charge you for even poisoning my mind. I don't know whether I'll succeed, but I'll think of nothing for the next 10 days except a little child of 3 singing to be, as he goes to the washstand to wash his hands, having had the little experience. Well, believe it or not, I told you I write songs fast. This is the best song I've ever written. Of course, it's the most difficult. She had hardly left, and I wrote the song. I didn't tell her for 10 days, and I like it as well as I do Tea for Two. After everything I do, doodle, 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 do, with lots of soap and water too, I wash my hands. I wash my hands, I wash my face, I put the soap back in its place. After everything I doodle, 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 do, for a little child of 3.
And for the next few minutes, you are going to be entertained by Rudy Vallee and his Connecticut Yankee.
Some girls are quickly forgotten and gone with the dawn of the day. Some you remember like last glowing embers haunting your memory and dreams. All I'm just a vagabond lover in search of a sweetheart, and I know that someday I'll discover the girl of my vagabond dreams.
I was the first to utilize the medium of radio as a means of exploiting the popular song and introducing popular song. We started on ABC, which is the Atlantic Broadcasting Company. So we were there for 8 hours a night from 7 to 3 in the morning at this Frank High Ho Club. I finished WABC at 11:30, tune in again on the station. 2 in the morning, we'd be on that station. So I'm on 3 different stations. In those days, you cleared no tunes. Of course, radio was made to plug songs. It was just tailor-made to order for music.
And he got everything for nothing. He put a star on his program, and the next thing you know, there'd be a motor craft up there donated by Eddie Cantor, or he would have a piano donated by somebody with his name and a little brass plaque. And he'd had about 12 bungalows. Each bungalow was named after some song that he made famous. like Vagabond Love, Kansas City Kitty and all that. And he had about 20 canoes. He had about 20 small rowboats. And he had these bicycle rafts. Everything that he had up there was for free. He had clay court tennis, clay court badminton. He had champagne for free, Planters peanuts for free. He didn't spend 7 cents on a collar button on anything, you know. But he was a great guy.
They simply said, put your name on it. We want you to introduce it. And it was understood. We never discussed royalties. It was always a technical, the usual amount of royalty that you'd expect. Never anything exorbitant like 5 cents or anything. It was a little penny a copy and my percentage of the mechanical royalties. As simple as that. And you might sign a contract, maybe you didn't sign a contract, but you knew you were going to get it. They said you were going to get it, you're going to get it.
Gene Austin, for instance, when he was recording in 1925, he was so popular that Leo Feist at Christmas time furnished his entire house, probably at a cost of $10,000 or $15,000, redecorating and all the furniture and everything, covering everything and so forth, and gave him a Cadillac car at Christmas time because Gene Austin, any record he made that was a hit sold at least 1 million copy records and 1 million sheet music copies.
Mammy, my little mammy, I'd walk 1 million miles for one of your smiles.
You take Al Jolson, there's another one. When he sang a song, the next day, all the music jobbers would immediately call up and order thousands and thousands of copies. And I went out to Cleveland to give him a song which he never even wrote. But his name appears on it.
The sun shines east, the sun shines west. I know where the sun shines best.
We used to pay what was known as plug money. Well, this was a genuine sort of financial arrangement. We would pay a bandleader a certain amount of money to play a certain tune. It was arranged that if it was a non-vocal, it was so many guineas. If it was a vocal, it was so many guineas. If it was a non-vocal, but the title was announced, it was so many guineas. If it was a vocal with the title announced, it was extra amount of guineas and so forth.
Mammy, I'm coming. Oh, God, I hope I'm not late. Mammy, look at me. Don't you know me? I'm your little baby. I'd walk 1 million miles for one of your smiles. My man.
The kind of songs you're hearing now out there, what are they? They were in the hands of people who have money for payola. Why are you getting the songs you're getting now? Not on merit. It's on who can push the songs, who can buy more marijuana and beer for the disc jockey, right? Who can get them more girls? The whole thing is based on money.
Hallelujah chorus from the Messiah, played by the Edison Concert Band.
Until the 1920s, recording was acoustical and sound was pretty crude. Nobody seemed to care much. But when competition from the newborn radio industry became tough, a group of scientists applying the principles of radio to the phonograph had found out how to reproduce sound electrically with what seemed dazzling fidelity. For the first time, much of the sonority of a big orchestra could be captured on records. And as the industry hastened to change over, Paul Whiteman became the band leader-elect of the 1920s. Many Whiteman records were among the best sellers of all time. But despite this, the lush days of the industry were over. Business, which had gradually been dropping off since 1921, came up against the Great Depression and collapsed entirely.
By the end of the 20s, the Alley publishers were in a bad way, ready to sell out. Well, 1927, Warner Brothers took a chance with the talking picture, came out with a jazz singer starring Al Jolson, with a number of old songs in it, Alley songs. And of course, as the talking pictures were a great success, Hollywood companies jumped on the bandwagon and started to turn out musicals. And for that, they needed popular songs cheaply and fast. They saw the Alley tottering. They offered price for the companies and they bought them up. So by 1930, practically all the old companies were owned by Hollywood.
Gone are my blues and gone are my tears. I've got good news to shout in your ears. The long-lost dollar has come back to the fold. With silver you can turn your dreams to gold. Oh, we're in the money. we're in the money. We've got a lot of what it takes to get along. We're in the money. The sky is sunny. Oh, man, depression, you are through. You done us wrong. Oh, we never see headline above red line today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye. Oh, we're in the money. Come on, my honey. Let's lend it, spend it, send it rolling around.
Ladies and gentlemen. I am privileged to say a few words to you in this most modern and novel manner. Privileged because it's the first living Vitaphone announcement ever made announcing the coming of one of the year's outstanding pictures. Al Jolson in The Jazz Singer. This picture with Al Jolson singing many of his songs in his own inimitable manner is sold out for many weeks in advance. Ah, boy, Al. He's sure happy to face tonight, huh? How do you like that? Huh? Well, you ain't seen nothing yet, brothers and sisters, as Al himself would put it.
I think we came out just the time when the old silent movie people were gradually going towards the sunset, you know, and we were coming over the horizon. Hollywood decided that musicals was a good market, so they went out and bought all the music companies. Every studio had a staff of songwriters. They hired anybody that could write a song. They must have had 100 songwriters out here.
Don't know why there's no sun up in the sky. Stormy weather since my gal and I ain't together.
With Fox, they must have had about 25 songwriters over at Fox alone. And they come out from under rocks. I don't know where they came from.
We're in the money. Look up, the skies are sunny. Old man, depression, you are through, you've done us wrong. We never see a headline, about red lines today. And when we see the landlord, we can look that guy right in the eye. We're in the money.
I came out originally in 1929 to do a picture called Spring Is Here, which seemed kind of silly to me because it was a show that Rodgers and Hart had written back in New York, and I wonder why they wanted extra songs for that. Here's two guys that wrote some beautiful songs for that picture. I could never understand why they wanted it. Well, anyhow, we wrote four or five songs for it. We had a song called Crying for the Carolines, Have a Little Faith in Me, Absence Makes the Heart Go Fonder for Somebody Else. But I still never gonna. I didn't stay long. I didn't like it. It was awful out here. I hated it.
And that was a golden age, the 30s. Some beautiful melodies have come out of that age, and some lovely songs. Forget songwriters were doing very, very well. The income on shows put us among the higher bracket of income. We were all living good lives, and it was very hard for people to step out of the comforts. Take a fellow like Irving Berlin, who came up from what they called Nigger Mike's Cafe in the Bowery, the lowest, fought as a waiter, and suddenly became affluent, became rich, wealthy, with accolades. Well, he blamed America for that. He said, America's the land of opportunity. He's great. It gave me... We must love America. God bless America.
God Bless America isn't just a song that I wrote, but it expresses my gratitude for the opportunities and the freedom to write that song and to the country that inspired it. Thank you very much.
That's very nice.
Vasco.
Okay. Can you repeat the God Bless America?
I mean, he didn't think of anything else excepting his own little bright spot in this lucky milieu. And he wrote a lot of wonderful songs, but were never dead. In fact, God Bless America is not only unpatriotic, but inhuman. Concerned with condition, society, or the welfare of man. They were concerned with having entertainment, selling copies, shows that were written for the tired businessman. After all, who had the money to go to a show? It was just the few rich or the middle class, the upper middle class, and they didn't want to be going to a show to be thinking about the poverty that and the drama of life. What they wanted to be was entertained.
'30s, there was only one organization, Tin Pan Alley, that licensed performing rights in music, and that was the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers, which is commonly known as ASCAP. It had a complete monopoly on the licensing of music. It didn't have a monopoly on music, it had a monopoly on the licensing of music, because there were many fine composers and writers who were not eligible to join this exclusive club, and they weren't compensated. But in any event, in the late 30s, in negotiating with the broadcasting industry, ASCAP took the position of a classical monopolist and said, we want a substantial increase. And since we got all the marbles, either you play according to our game or you don't play.
I think you've got to understand how music became commercially successful up to 1940. A song was judged by the number of live performances it had on primetime radio networks. If a Rudy Valley or a Bing Crosby, who were the great stars and the great recording artists, were to introduce a song on one of their commercial programs,
and if it would get the leading number of performances in that week, it would be number one in the country. A recording need not have been released, sheet music may not yet have been published, but that song would be number one simply by virtue of the fact that it had received in 1 week more live performances in the period from 7 to midnight on network radio. That made it number one.
Now, during the 30s, families spent their nights in one of two ways. Either they stayed at home and listened to network radio, or they went to the motion picture theater. The motion picture business made its money out of a percentage of the gross at the box office.
Here comes Adolph Zucker, the president of Paramount Pictures. Here comes Mrs. Walker
and her husband,
Mayor Jimmy Walker. Hurry up, Jimmy. Hurry up, Jimmy. You'll be late again.
The radio networks, on the other hand, made their money by delivering an audience to the advertisers. So both of them were struggling to get the majority of that audience.
Come in, Tommy.
Deep within my heart lies a melody, yeah. A song of old San Antonio.
San Antonio.
Where in dreams I live with a melody.
But the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers was then dominated by the motion picture-owned publishing companies. The majority of its members of the board of directors were representatives of the motion picture industry. So in 1939, when ASCAP wanted to double its license fee from the radio networks, this was really just another battle in the struggle for that audience. There was no economic incentive for New York publishers to involve themselves in non-ASCAP music, country music, for instance, because it got no return. But for every girl that was seduced to a performance of Bing Crosby while sitting in the rumble seat of a car listening to a car radio, there were an awful lot of girls had the same thing happen to them listening to the country music stations of the South.
Good morning!
For the first time, Tin Pan Alley was no longer able to manufacture all the music. The people who created this non-ASCAP music were now sophisticated. They knew that they no longer needed the Tin Pan Alley apparatus. They had their own. They had their own publishing companies. They had their own record companies. They now had their own agency, Broadcast Music Incorporated, BMI. They had their own audience, and they knew how to get to that audience.
The end of 1940, the contract between the radio industry and ASCAP was over, and midnight, January 1, 1941, most stations had no license to play ASCAP music, and they had to resort to the music licensed by BMI. And to most people's surprise, I couldn't say anybody's surprise, most people's surprise, BMI was able to supply this music.
I'm gonna take a trip in that good old Russell's ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. I'm gonna shout and sing until heaven rings when I'm bidding.
The music business had only understood New York, Los Angeles, and Chicago. These were, to them, the centers of production, the centers of exploitation. That was America's popular music. But now there was a problem. The audience was far more sophisticated than it had ever been. The authentic audience was now dictating what became popular. You could no longer go to a handful of radio personalities and get them to play your version of a country song and make it number one. The audience was insisting on an authentic performance.
I'm going far beyond the sky. I'm gonna shout and sing until heaven rings when I'm bidding this world goodbye.
We can make the Ford car look like a Cadillac, which we've done, but you can't make a popular songwriter be Rogers. Or Arlen, or Burton Lane. Unfortunately, you can't do that. But we have tried to do with songwriting what Ford has tried to do with cars. It works better with cars.
And here, it's called, you can't see it,
It's not commercial. My wife put that on there. And this is books of songs that I wrote. Look at this crazy thing. Look at that. Isn't that ridiculous? But we've shown you some of the more important ones. And I thank you for listening. I want to thank everybody for being there and watching me perform on your little TV set. It's been my pleasure. Not an easy task, but Tony's made it easy, and he's asked me the right kind of questions. I hope I've given you some answers that will please you, and I can shake hands again with the English people, the Welsh, the whole thing, the whole gang. Bye-bye, folks.